Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV is supported by Berks Community Action Program.
Welcome to Diversity, the Wider Vision. I'm Joseph Amprey, and we're going to talk about a minority that isn't discussed tonight. Usually we talk about Blacks or Asians or Hispanics or women. Tonight we're going to talk about some things that we don't like here said. For example, we're not allowed to use curse words, four-letter words on the air. I'm going to ask you to stop using words like handicap and disabled, and replace them with words like challenges. For example, we have 331.9 million Americans. Of those 331.9 million Americans, 54 are labeled disabled. We're gonna cut that word out and say they face some challenges. There are people who are blind, deaf, dyslexic. We're gonna cut those terms out and talk about the challenges they face. I'll tell you about some of my challenges. Several years ago, maybe more like 15 years ago, my son was in medical school, came home one day and said, "Dad, you're ADD." And I said, I thought it was, you know, he likes to challenge me, he was challenging me. And that means attention deficit disorder. I then began to look at my entire life and how I process things and how I learn. And I realized that I do have attention deficit disorder, but somehow when I was in my 20s, actually my teens in college, I was given study habits that are good for that. When I was in going to high school and middle school, my dad was relentless about checking my homework. So I really didn't learn how to study until I got to college. But I want just to bring that up, that that's a disability that people talk about. We're gonna cut that word disability out. We have people who are deaf and sign has become important. We have people who are blind. I have one of my best students has a PhD now, was blind. And I think he has other skills, other senses were stronger because of that. Well, tonight I have two fantastic guests who are going to talk about challenges they face. And they're going to give us some suggestions about how people can overcome challenges and how they made major contributions for people who have the same challenges that they happen to have. My first guest is Bailey Bodien. Bailey, thanks for coming on. Tell my audience what your challenge is, if you would.
So I actually have a neurological condition called chronic migraines. I got my diagnosis about 2.5 years ago. I was actually dealing with this about for another two years beforehand. So I've been dealing with chronic migraines for about the last 5 years. It's really been challenging. I went my whole senior year wearing sunglasses because I was so photosensitive that the computer lights and the school lights were so overwhelming and made the headache worse. So I currently am a second year athletic training student at Alvernia University, and I'm very glad I don't have to go to class with sunglasses anymore. My eyes have adjusted and I have learned different habits to adjust my schooling career around my challenge.
Let me ask you a question. I used to have migraines. Yeah. And the way mine came on would be that at first, usually came on when I was under a lot of stress. And they would come on, I would, it looked like there was no pain, but my vision was like there was something missing. Like, for example, I might see part of something and part of something else. And so then it got worse, and usually I would throw up, and then it was gone. Are yours in any way similar to that?
What it sounds like you're describing is like you have an aura. So I currently In my migraine journey, I don't have auras. So an aura is can be like a flash of light, or like you described, like a loss in vision, or just something wasn't correct. I don't have those. So I live with a daily headache. So it's really hard to decipher when my migraines, being the bigger episodes, would come on. I do have some triggers. So triggers are things that can make the migraine escalate. So certain types of foods, like I know watermelon and shrimp are some of my triggers. Certain smells, like I mentioned earlier, light is a really big one. Loud noises. So I always am carrying my earplugs, my sunglasses, and I always have those types of tools, no matter what bag I'm carrying.
Now, I'm impressed because you're in lots of activities. Share with our audience all the activities that you're involved in.
Yeah, so over here at Alvernia, like I said, I'm a second-year athletic training student in the Accelerated Master's Program. So I'm the president of the Multicultural Club. And with the Multicultural Club, we get a chance to educate not only our students, but our staff and community here at Alvernia. We are able to do different types of events, like being able to try different foods from different countries, listening to different types of music, and just really experiencing different cultures together as a community. I'm also part of our athletic training club, and I get the pleasure of working with our Justice, Equity, and Inclusion Council, as well as our mission and ministry here on campus at Alvernia.
So you're a busy lady.
I am a busy lady on top of school.
And now, what would you say your biggest challenge is? You know, you're a college student, you're doing well in college, you're in all these activities, you're very pleasant to talk to, you come off as being very positive. So I'm sure that you aren't always smiling like this. What are the biggest challenges you think you've overcome?
My biggest challenges are those days where the pain is just so unbearable, and you just have to shut everything down and say, I know I have this test, but I need to take care of myself before I can even study for that test, or deal with the pain and take 15 minutes to mask some of the pain before studying or doing activities. It's really about taking care of yourself right now before getting to the bigger accomplishment in school. Because without taking that little time, you can't focus and take the time later to do your studying. That's probably one of the biggest things of time managing, that being able to say no is one of the hugest challenges, because I'm so involved and I love opportunities like the panel tonight and being able to work with different offices on campus with our club, but sometimes you just have to say no.
Well, you're president of the Multicultural Club at Alvernia. Did they pull you on to get you to do that? Was there an election? Tell us about how that happened.
So I was actually elected the historian, doing a lot of their social media, doing a lot of their posters my first year in. And then their president had to step down because she was getting her master's. And they said, you're already doing a lot. You're helping to plan. You're helping to run events. Why don't you become the president? So I was nominated president and elected president in November of last year. So I've been in this position about a year and a half to 2 years.
And you took it willfully? It wasn't a lot of pressure?
I did. It's amazing. It's truly an experience. A shout out to our advisor, Carla Mannix. She works here at the university as well. She has been able to guide me through different steps with the Multicultural Club, as well as getting me contacts with like our international Office of International Students and different people here on campus that can help me be more effective as a leader in that multicultural role.
Now, you were diagnosed in high school. Is that correct?
I was. I was diagnosed my senior year of high school.
Were there any people at your school, role models, or that were really helpful and inspirational for you, encouraging?
I really had a great support system. So I actually started student managing the football team my sophomore year of high school. And I had some guy friends that I was really close with, that they were huge supporters of me. I actually had one of my best friends, Kelsey Felix, was able to, we had the same, almost the same class schedule. So she was able to be a support system there throughout the day, as well as if I had an understanding with the teacher, we would talk beforehand with the diagnosis. If I just needed to leave because it was so bad, I would just get up and leave, and Kelsey would kind of be my communicator with that. That was a huge support system. My teachers were a huge support system as well, to be able to feel comfortable to just get up and leave in the middle of class. Because again, I'm a student, I love to learn, but that was really hard to be able to have to uproot myself in order to go deal with the pain, because the pain was so bad.
Now, computers are everywhere now. You know, we just, and I must admit that I am really challenged with computers. And you've mentioned that the lights can be a problem for you. How do you handle all the lights in these computers?
So currently, in my dorm room, I have very minimal light. I have one lamp that I turn on that lights up my whole room, and that's pretty much all the light I need. With computers, it's a little bit more challenging, that I have to take those breaks. I have blue light glasses that I wear. I have red tint glasses that will help take some of the filtered lights out when I work with my computer. Strategies like putting the red filter on your computer, on my cell phone, but it's really being able to time manage and say, all right, I can do 15 minutes on the computer, then I'm going to go to book work, and then I'm going to work more on the computer, and then go back to book work.
So you go from one thing to the other.
Yeah.
That's what I do with my ADD. I tend to do lots of activities, but one for a little bit here, a little bit here, a little bit here, and then come back and come back and come back, and it seems to work. Well, it has, and for a long time, I didn't know why I was doing things that way. So, you know, my son made this revelation to me. You have any siblings?
I do. I have an older sister. She's 3 years older than I am. She's a physical therapist assistant over at Lancaster General at an outpatient facility. And so it's really nice that I get a chance to kind of talk shop with her because of the kinesiology and all the exercise science between physical therapy assistant and athletic training. So it's nice to have someone to talk shop with.
Sounds like you like science.
I do. I really do. Like, I'm a science girl.
Well, you know, one of the things that I love is when people who are in science and math have good interpersonal skills, because all too often, the guys who have great quantitative skills don't handle people well, and people who handle people well can't count and compute. So you seem to have put them both together, and that's a blessing.
Best of both worlds.
Did you take a lot of math when you were younger?
In high school, I actually took an extra math course because I really wanted to. And I really love math. I really love to learn. But it's really the drive and the motivation to learn that gets me super excited about college and being excited about the world, because the world is so vast. There's so much stuff to learn about. And I'm so excited for the opportunities that I get to have here at the university to learn and to educate, be educated.
The nice thing is that you're with a lot of international students. I had the joy of working with international students, and you get to find out other cultures, other foods. So have you discovered any foods that you like from other cultures?
I've discovered, so our, like I said, our previous president, before she left and I took over, she was from, her family's from Mexico, and some of the Mexican dishes are really, really good. I have one of my e-board members right now, she is Dominican Republic, I believe, and she made flan for one of our global cafes, and I'm like, I've never had flan, and it was so good. So it's like, kind of like a cheesecake, but it's lighter and like spongier. Yeah. It was really good. That probably has to be one of my favorites, is flan.
Glad to hear that. Now, you're a woman, and you're a president. Have you had any chauvinistic men who said, how can this woman be in charge of me? Have you run into any of that?
I have not. So actually, our club is really heavily female-dominated. So we actually are looking for males to join our club and give us some more ideas on what they want to see here at the university. Not only it's the multicultural club, but just as a student here, that we can integrate in different ways through different clubs. Like I said, Jai Equity and Inclusion, that's really what we're about here at Alvernia, making the experience justice, equity, and inclusion for all people.
Sounds like you are really doing well. I'm really proud of you. Now, I'm going to go and talk to Chris a few minutes, but I'll come back and talk about your foray into football. I'm a football fanatic.
Yeah. And
as a matter of fact, last night I saw probably one of the best quarterbacks in the NFL, Aaron Rodgers, have to leave the game because of rib and oblique issues. And the trainers have played a very important role in that. And so we'll talk about some of the injuries you've seen and how you help these football players overcome their challenges. But we'll come back to you in a few minutes. But again, thanks so much for joining us. You are such a breath of fresh air and enthusiasm. We love it. Thank you so much. Let's talk to Chris Kaag for a few minutes. He has something called I Am Able Foundation. Chris, how long have you been doing this I Am Able Foundation?
The I Am Able Foundation, I started back in 2007. So we've been doing it for over 15 years now.
Wow. What motivated you to get it started?
When I was first diagnosed with my condition, I was down at Kennedy Krieger down in Baltimore, and it was primarily a children's hospital. So I was a 21-year-old Marine, you know, still walking in there, and I saw these kids on breathing tubes, feeding tubes, confined to chairs, confined to beds, and that had a big impact on me. So I wanted to try to give these kids the chance to live a normal childhood like I did. But at the time, I just started doing adaptive sports, and I realized how expensive it is to be disabled. So when I first started, I wanted to just raise money to be able to take those obstacles out of people's way, to be able to get them out and lead the most fulfilling and active lifestyle.
Now, have you had your challenge all your life, or was something that came on later in life?
Yeah, this was a gift to me when I turned 21. So I was like 2 weeks before my 21st birthday is when I first started noticing symptoms. So none of us had any idea. But then once I was diagnosed, then we got the rest of my family diagnosed, and we realized that my two younger brothers have it, as well as my mom. She's obviously the carrier. So, you know, it was pretty profound for all of us to be able to realize that, you know, this is something that we never knew existed.
What are your symptoms?
My symptoms now?
Yes.
Can't walk. I can still stand up. So it's like, these are the kind of things that I try to remind myself. It's like, I still have some abilities. I can still stand up. I still have the ability to do things, but I'm in a chair, and, you know, I have spasticity in my legs, and I have a lot of things that, you know, sometimes I'll fall and, you know, have some challenges. So, you know, it's just like anything, you know, there's always somebody out there who has it worse or has, I mean, listening to her, I mean, talking about her headaches, I mean, that kills me, because I am the biggest crybaby when it comes to having a headache. So it's like, I commend you for the upbeat attitude that you have. And, you know, it's like, that's something that you really, I commend you, because dealing with pain, I think, is a lot worse. The only pain that I have is the pain that I cause myself.
So up until you were 21, you had none of these symptoms. Everything was fine.
Correct. Yep. I was a 21-year-old Marine. I mean, I thought I had the world figured out. I was running around doing so many physical activities, and, you know, being a U.S. Marine, you're sort of expected to do a lot of physical things. So I had no symptoms, and then slowly started to.
How long had you been Marines before you began to discover you had this issue?
I came in 94, and that was in 97, so about 3 years.
Well, you know, in my previous work with challenges, I found that people who are born with them handle them better than people who acquire them later in life, because that's they know that. But so you ought to be commended, because you were doing fine and suddenly you had this challenge, but yeah. You overcome it and you're reaching out to others.
Yes, I very much agree with you. I mean, I deal with kids and young people who are born with a condition, and they are the happiest, most resilient people ever. And it's like, I think that it's really great that they can be commended for the things that they deal with. There's obviously a lot of people like myself who face challenges later in life. And yes, it's not good. I was blessed to be able to have the attitude that I have and have the outlook that I do to be as happy as I am.
I'm from Baltimore. And so when you say Hopkins, I had one of my degrees from Hopkins. But you were there not because you lived there, but because you were there to get treated. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Yeah, I was being seen at Walter Reed Hospital, military hospital down in D.C. And okay. The doctor, who is the world-renowned expert on my condition, was based over at Kennedy Krieger. So that's why I started going down there, because all my doctors were over there.
And you drive?
I do. Yep.
What you must have a car that's made special for you. How do you do that?
Yeah, you know what? This is the best time to be disabled. There's so many. Well, not disabled. We're not going to say that word. We're going to say adaptive. Uh-huh. I do the same thing everybody else is doing. I do it differently. So uh-huh. You know, hand controls and suicide knob. You know, it's amazing what you can do nowadays. And that's the thing. I get that question a lot from people. Like, can you drive? It's like, yes, I can. I can pretty much do anything that everybody does. I just do it differently.
And I guess the cars are probably specially equipped for what your needs are.
So the hand controls, you could buy a regular car and then put the hand control. You have to get them specially installed. Uh-huh. But I don't have as many issues and as many complications that I need, you know, really fancy, more technological stuff. I just need hand controls.
Now, I find very often that people who have a challenge have other strengths, that certain skills have become stronger. Are there any skills you have that become even stronger since you found out your challenge?
Absolutely. I mean, I don't think I'd be sitting here doing the things that I'm doing if I did not have this. I mean, this was probably one of the best things that ever happened to me. I really would give anything in this world to have my legs back and be able to do the things that I did before. But at the same time, I think this really put a lot of good perspective into my head, and it really made me appreciate all the things that, you know, are great about my life. Because there's a lot of people out there in other countries or other places that don't have it as good as we do. So I'm very fortunate to live in the country we live in and, you know, have the abilities that I have. I have an amazing wife. I have a son, you know, so I'm a pretty lucky guy.
Does your son or does your wife have any challenges? Do they have any challenges?
Negative. No. Negative. Uh-huh. They take care of me.
They're very understanding and supportive.
Yeah, absolutely.
Your foundation is called I Am Able.
I Am Able Foundation, yes.
I like that because it suggests don't say I can't do anything. I'm able. What made you come up with that beautiful, fantastic, creative title?
It was one of those things. I don't like soft music, and you know, people feel sorry for people who have different abilities. It's like I really wanted to empower as many people as I can, and I just wanted to make sure that they know, yeah, you have some challenges, but don't concentrate on your challenges. Concentrate on your abilities and the things that you still can do despite the fact that you had these challenges. So I want to try to motivate as many people as possible.
I'm going to ask you this question several times, but I'm going to ask you the first time now. If someone wants to get in touch with you and either help or get help, how do they do that?
It's the IAmableFoundation.org. So it's the letter I, the letter M, AbleFoundation.org. And we have different programs. We provide adaptive equipment grants to be able to help people get the equipment that's going to get them active and get them outside. Because unfortunately, being disabled is not cheap. So, you know, a regular bike that we got for a 5-year-old boy, he was one of my first grant recipients. His bike cost $1,900. You know, for a 5-year-old, that's pretty much unheard of. And there's a lot of people who just don't have those resources to make that happen. So we want to provide those you know, ways for people to get over those obstacles.
And then so we have contacts for getting grants for these kinds of things.
Yes. And then we also provide, you know, workout classes for kids with cognitive challenges, you know, kids with autism, Down syndrome. You know, I absolutely love these classes because we give these kids the opportunity to thrive and be around and make friends and, you know, do the same thing everybody else is doing. Again, we just have to do it differently and just change it up for them.
You know, one thing that gets me excited hearing you say this is that I have some challenges. First of all, I'm not mechanically inclined. I'm talking computers. So when I do conquer something like this, I get the greatest high. If I take a screwdriver and fix something, I go, wow, look, I did it. So I can see where you've taken people who thought they were in some way limited and found them a way to overcome that. And that's got to be exciting.
It's very rewarding to see the changes that people have in their outlook on life when they realize the possibilities. And that's, you know, that's what I say all the time. We're redefining possible because, you know, sometimes people don't realize what is available to them and what their potential is. And then we're here to show them that you can pretty much accomplish whatever you want. You just have to figure out a different way to do it. And we're going to help you.
Some of our greatest performers and speakers were people who stuttered at one point.
Yeah.
And we're surprised to learn that. James Earl Jones was a stutterer. There's so many stars. John Sossel, many, who we see in TV are stuttered one time and they overcame it and they excelled in the area where they least had a problem. So that's always awfully exciting. Yeah. Now, how many people do you have involved with your foundation?
That work for us or people who are just, you know, receiving services from us?
You probably have lots of volunteers.
We have a lot of volunteers, and then we depend on our volunteers are amazing. And the cool thing about the volunteers is that they get something out of volunteering as well as us, because, you know, they see the benefits of the things that they're able to do. Like we have our different races. We have a duathlon in September, you know, of all abilities, you know, people who are in adaptive equipment plus able-bodied, we're all together at the same time. And it's amazing to see the community and the camaraderie that we create with so many different abilities working together.
Let's talk about some of the challenges that you work with. You have people who are in wheelchairs.
Correct.
You have people who are autistic.
Correct.
Deaf.
Yes. And visually impaired.
Wow.
We actually did a walk with the Berks Vision Resource Center. These people are all, you know, seeing impaired. We teamed them up with veterans. And veterans, all they did was they simply provided them an arm to hold on to. And we went out for a walk because, you know, these people who are seeing impaired, you know, the thing that they wanted the most, they wanted to feel the sun on their face. They wanted to smell the grass. They wanted to feel, you know, how it is to be outside and go for a walk in nature. So we got these veterans and they helped them to be able to have a very fulfilling day.
One of my concerns are people getting stared at who seem different.
Yep.
Tell us about some of the ways you help people overcome that or things they say, because sometimes the people who are around are uncomfortable and you want to make them comfortable. Any suggestions you have in that regard?
I empower anybody who is different to be able to put a smile on your face. I mean, I smile and say, how you doing to everybody. I don't care who it is. And then once they see a guy in a chair, you know, doing that and smiling at them, I think it kind of breaks down that unsureness or that uncomfortable feeling they may have because I'm different. But it's like not everybody's smiley, not everybody's happy. So, you know, doesn't matter if you're disabled or not. There's people out there who have to adjust their attitude to make everybody around them feel a lot better.
Now you're located in Reading, is that correct?
We're in Wyomissing, right outside of Reading.
We're in Wyomissing. Did you start here? Did you start in another state? Or say, where'd you get started?
I did get started here in Reading. I actually lived downtown in Reading back when I started. And then I moved out here to Wyomissing because I had a gym. So I used my gym to be able to house my foundation when I first started.
Are you a native of Berks County?
I am, yes.
So I'm always complaining about the talented folks who leave. You stayed.
I came back, and that's the thing. There's a lot of people who boomerang back. I left. I graduated from Canton, Ohio, and then when I got out of the Marine Corps, my parents had moved back to Wyomissing, so I moved back, and I've stayed here ever since.
Now, you mentioned having a brother who has a similar condition.
Yep. I have two younger brothers who have it.
Did it come on at 21 like yours or earlier, or what happened?
No, they were actually later. I think my one brother was 29, and the other brother was 27. So their prognosis or their condition right now has been okay. I mean, they use chairs for longer distances and they use canes to walk around, but they're not as bad as me yet.
But the main disability or main challenge is in the legs.
Correct.
And what's it called again?
Adrenomyeloneuropathy.
One of the things that amazes me is that most physicians, doctors, know all these long terms, these words. And of course, you're probably pronounced so often that it's no big deal for you.
Now it's not. When I first got started, I was the guinea pig for my neurology department because nobody had ever heard of this disease. So it was something I felt like I was a showboat or a show pony. I was showing all the doctors what it is that I had and showed my symptoms and stuff like that. So,
okay. Is it neurological? Is this condition? Is it solved with nerves? How does this get started?
It's neurological. So it's a degenerative nerve disease. It was prompted by a head injury I sustained when I was 20 years old. And then, when I got out of the Marine Corps, I went to a cane. Then I started using two canes. And then within 5 years, I was in a chair. So it kind of, it wasn't as drastic as like having a traumatic accident and breaking my neck and waking up the next day and not having anything. Like over the years, it took probably about 5 years to be able to really, take hold. And it started giving me a lot more problems.
You were warned to expect it, I guess.
I was what to expect it?
Warned by doctors that it's going to get worse. This is what's going to happen. It prepared you for it, I guess.
Not really. I mean, and to be honest, at the time I was diagnosed, I was 21 years old. And my doctor said, you might be in a chair in 5 years. And at the time, I was still walking around. So it really didn't hit me. It really didn't make a huge impact. So I kind of had to just figure it out as I went. But that's the thing I really feel. Like the Marine Corps is what helped save my life because it really gave me the ability to overcome all my obstacles. And Marines, if you're given a challenge, if you're given a task to do, you have to figure out how to make it happen, regardless of whatever challenges you face. So that has been something I feel has been very beneficial for my attitude and my outlook on the things that I do.
So that Semper Fidelis tough challenge attitude made you. Sure. Wow. I'm going to ask you now, but then I'm going to talk to Bailey for a few minutes and come back to you. But tell us again how we can get in touch with you if we want to volunteer or get help.
I am able, letter I, letter M, ablefoundation.org.
That's pretty simplistic, so it shouldn't be too difficult. I'm going to come back to you in a few minutes. Again, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Got a couple of questions for you now, if you're ready. You are going to be a athletic trainer if things go well.
Correct.
You may be with the Eagles or the Cowboys or the Giants or 49ers. So you might be on the sidelines or in the booth. All of these guys face their challenges. You've already done this. Let me ask you, I'm a sports fanatic. One of my biggest challenges has been asking for getting help. There's something to me that says that you don't need to help me. I can do this myself. And oftentimes I do need the help, but I don't want to admit it. You've probably seen this very often. You've probably seen big macho defensive tackles who don't want to admit that they need your help. Yes. How do you help them get to do this?
So I saw this more when I was working with high school. A lot of it is, they got to be willing to ask for help. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't force him to drink. I had a lot of players that were like, oh, I'm okay. I called it the big man syndrome. Uh-huh. I said, okay. And you just let them walk it off. And then they'll eventually come back. The help has been extended, but they'll eventually come back if they really need you. And also, they got to listen to their body. With sports, you got to listen to your body in any condition. Anybody has to listen to their body. I mean, when the hunger response says, I'm hungry, I'm going to go eat something. Or if I'm thirsty, I'm going to go drink something. We just, all as individuals, whether we have challenges or not, we have to listen to our bodies because our bodies know us best.
Now, you're in a unique program because you're in an undergraduate program now, but eventually you're going to earn a master's degree. And you're probably going to do an internship. Maybe you'll be with the Eagles or the Commanders or wherever. What's the process? Have you talked to anybody who's already gone through the process, who's come in and gone off to become, a lot of times they call it sports medicine. Have you talked to anybody who's gone through the process and is there where you want to go?
So I currently haven't really talked to anyone at the professional level. I'm still working on those contacts, but I have, within our athletic training club, I have talked to some of the higher up athletic trainer students. Uh-huh. So our fourth year, we are still taking classes. So we're in a part-time clinical. So that's about 20 hours a week. And then our fifth year, which is our last year to obtain our professional degree, which is the master's, we are in full clinicals. And then we also have a research mod between year four and year five, which is clinical based as well. But the Alvernia has great opportunities. We are partnered with St. Luke. Our clinical staff is through St. Luke's right here at the university. So we get an opportunity to use St. Luke's name to go to Governor Mifflin. Is just one of the sites within Alvernia's spectrum of internships and clinical opportunities that I can think of off the top of my head. Harley Davidson. So our athletic trainer position is so vast and so growing. So athletic trainers treat the physically active. So we can go the traditional route of sports, working with youth the whole way up to geriatrics, or we could go the non-traditional route, being athletic trainers for hospital staff or performing arts, or even like big companies that have very labor intensive workers, like Harley Davidson down in York County is one of our clinical sites here for Alvernia. And it's just a great opportunity. You can work in the sports medicine office, and there's so many females getting into the field that our field is just growing so rapidly, and there's so many opportunities. So my traditional dream of working with professional football might not be the ultimate dream when I get out. It might be working with a big company like Amazon if they decide to employ athletic trainers, or it might even be going home to York County and working at Harley Davidson. Something that you have to feel your passion when you work, and being able to help people as well is part of the passion. So you have to have passion no matter where you are, but you also have to have drive and motivation to be where you're at.
You said something that I've heard so often, which seems so important, that you heard it before. Find something you like or love, and you'll never work a day in your life. And you obviously have the passion, which you're blessed. You're blessed to have the passion and like what you're doing. Some other questions that I think are important. If somebody has migraines, severe migraines, can you recommend some hospitals or doctors that you think they should contact?
So that's really based off your region of where you're living. I know I'm a York County girl, so I live in about an hour west, right over the river. Uh-huh. So I highly recommend Lancaster General Neurology. But it's also, you gotta go through the weave. Seeing your primary care physician is really where I started off at. And my primary care physician couldn't take care of it. Therefore, they sent me to the neurologist. And then I was seeing a couple of neurologists in there. But it's, you have to go through the steps, regardless where you go. Because they have to do their checklist, and with insurance they have to get things approved. That was the longest process of my diagnosis was, okay, you have to try a medication for at least 6 to 8 weeks before you can say, okay, that doesn't work. And then you try another medication and then 6 to 8 weeks and that doesn't work. So you could be on a medication that in 3 weeks, you know, it's not going to work, but you have to stay on it for another 4 to 6. So it's really, really frustrating to go through that process, regardless of what condition you have.
But you've done it.
I have.
All right. We're blessed because you're in Berks County and you're a York County lady. How do we get this vibrant, enthusiastic York County lady to come to Berks County? How do we do that? What motivates you to come to Alvernia?
So I was really intrigued at the Office of Mission and Ministry, as well as all the student organizations that are on campus. But I grew up in the church back home, and I was really drawn to Alvernia's open faith. I call it an open faith policy of not being discriminated for living out your faith and practicing your faith. And you can talk about it in class. I grew up in a public school, and that's very kind of frowned upon because of the separation of church and state. And so it was just so breathtaking to be able to live openly with the faith. And that's really one thing that has been keeping me going with this condition, is being able to live out my faith daily and having opportunities to get with other believers and continue to pray for one another and such.
So you know when to call on God, we need some more help.
Yes, sir.
That's a blessing. Now, let me just say this to you. I'm a psychologist, and I can tell you that even a psychologist and psychiatrist who are atheists encourage people who are religious to pray, because they found that statistically, people who pray get well faster than those who don't. Now, the atheists think it's because of the attitude, but you and I know the real reason why they get better. You know that God answers prayers. But even those who don't believe have seen the results. And so I want you to continue to be so positive. I tell you, what really blew my mind was I saw the name Bailey, and I assumed you were a guy. And it wasn't, and I hadn't seen you. I talked with you on the phone, and I said, this guy's got a high voice. And then Freeman told me, she's here. I was ready to go, wait a minute, it's a guy. But you have really been a breath of fresh air. Thank you for coming on. And please continue to do what you're doing. We are blessed with people who are positive, enthusiastic, and who overcome challenges, because there's somebody out there who's facing the same kinds of migraines, and maybe they'll look at you and say, wow, there is hope. But thank you so much for your positivity.
Thank you for having us on. This is a great way not only to educate ourselves within the community, but to educate others about what we go through as human beings, and we get to deal with just as individuals.
Okay. If you want to see yourself, we'll be televised at 8 p.m. on the 12th, which is a Monday of December. And again, the following Wednesday, which is the 14th at 10 a.m. And the following Friday, which is the 16th at 3 p.m. And then the following Sunday at noon. And of course, because you're in Berks County, you can watch it on Channel 15. However, if you ever want to watch it after the 14th, you can go online, bctv.org. And you can see yourself, or others can see you and be inspired, because it's on all the time then, based on the date. Its air date will be Monday, December the 12th. And of course, if when you go online, you look for the program for that date, if you see it, you know, anytime on the 14th or thereafter. Thanks again. God bless, and continue to be the bright, shining star you are.
Thank you for having us. I really appreciate it.
Let's get back to Chris. Got some questions for you. Chris, are you still there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm going to ask you this again, and I'll ask you again. If somebody wants to contact you, they go to what? IamAble.org?
IamAbleFoundation.org.
IamAbleFoundation.org.
Right.
And people can get called to get help. They can they can also volunteer.
Absolutely. So we do three big events a year. So people are more than welcome to sign up to help us out. We have a triathlon in May. We have a duathlon in September. And we have our bash in March. But then we also have, you know, classes on Tuesdays and Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. You know, this is our I Am Fit classes. These are kids, you know, young people with cognitive challenges. And it's the most motivating, encouraging environment that you'll ever go to. So I tell people all the time, it's like, if you're having a bad day, come out there for an hour, because you will not leave without a smile. You know, seeing the smiles in these kids' faces and just seeing the energy that we provide them and give them the opportunity to thrive. It's pretty an amazing time.
Well, I'm going to write down some phone numbers and addresses, because I want to come out and get inspired. So where are you located, address-wise?
We are located at, if you just type in the IMAL Foundation in Wyoming, you could find it, but it's at 117 Hill Avenue.
Okay.
Building 17 in Wyomissing.
Okay. 117, building 17. 17. I have a reoccurring theme.
Try to make it as simple as possible.
And you were a Marine, Semper Fidelis. So
thank you, sir.
Did you go in right out of high school?
I did. Yes. My dad and my grandfather and my uncle were all Marines, and my brother after me. But I wanted to be a Marine ever since I was about 8 years old.
So it's a family tradition.
Family tradition. And they didn't force me to do it, but it was one of those things I really admired. My dad, my grandfather, my uncle, and just hearing the stories about the Marine Corps, you know, and all the things that the Marine Corps does really well.
And you were already in when this occurred. But it had already given you a foundation of courage, strength, stamina, conditioning.
Absolutely. It just gave me a different... See, I redefined who I was when I went to boot camp, because I was a pretty heavy 230-pound guy when I was 17 years old. I was very out of shape. But when I got to boot camp, I started to think about my teammates before I started to think about me. And I never quit on anything. I thought I was going to die pretty much every day. But at the same time, it's like I really started to think about my teammates and the challenges that I needed to face in order for them to be able to succeed. So that was the thing that I think that redefined who I was.
You were 230 pounds. How tall were you?
5'11".
5'11". And then you turned that fat into muscle.
Got out 3 months later, and I was 180 pounds and could run 3 miles in 20 minutes, 20 pull-ups, 100 crunches. I totally changed my entire life.
One of the things I find amazing is that oftentimes people who are fit don't look as heavy as they are, because muscle doesn't weigh as much as fat. So you'll see a guy who might be 180 pounds and you'll think he's a different size because it's solid. But you went from 230 to 180, so in a short period of time. But again, you felt better, you felt good, you were energetic. That's very important.
And I tell you what, I mean, that's the thing that I have done for my life. I still remain active. You know, I'm up every morning at 4:15. I work out. You know, I go out for rides. I do as much as I can to stay active. And it's the most beneficial thing for you, physically, but it's at the same way, you know, emotionally and your mind. Because to be able to go outside and do the things that, you know, I used to do when I was walking around is very empowering. And that's why we try to get as many people as active as possible, so they can see, you know, the possibilities are still there.
Now, please enlighten us. You're in a chair. Yep. Tell us the exercises that you do in a chair.
Yeah, so you can do a lot of things in a chair.
Of course,
so,
I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's all upper body when I work out. But I mean, when I go mountain biking, you know, that's all arms. But, you know, it's an amazing opportunity to get out in the mountains, get out in the trails, you know, see all the things that everybody else is seeing, despite the fact that I'm doing it differently.
And I'm sure your diet, you probably watch your diet also, since you're so active.
Yeah, I try to be good most of the time.
Well, I heard about what you do, about your foundation. That's how I heard about you, because I always want to do a show around this time of year for people who are challenged physically. Yep. And so you have to tell people how great you are. The word is out. I always say that the guys who are doing things don't have to do too much talking because they'll just tell us what a great job you're doing. People rave about what you're doing. I'm going to ask you this. How can we contact you?
The I Am Able Foundation, letter I, letter M, ablefoundation.org. Here from anybody.
And I want to thank you for what you do. I want to encourage those who want to get help or want to volunteer the gift to give or get help to give you to contact you and get involved. Thank you for being with us tonight. And thank you for all you do. God bless you.
We're sure appreciate you. It was a pleasure meeting you you both.
Well, I'm inspired. I usually leave guys like you pumped up saying, let's go do it. Thank you so much. This program is going to air actually on December the 12th. So for my viewing audience, if you want to get involved with giving me ideas for future shows, you'll see my phone number and address up there. And I'll tell you that we'll have a show in January. It'll be on the second Monday in January also, although we'll tape it earlier because we're now taping the shows earlier. But again, I want to thank the people at BCTV who make this happen. They are talented. Now, Mr. John Fregina, Ms. Joan Freeman, all the people who make this happen, we want to thank you for all you do. Want to say good night. God bless. Take care.
Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV is supported by Berks Community Action Program.